Hello, everybody. I am Fabio. So welcome here. Let's begin this talk. And please, if you don't understand me, my English, okay? You can ask me. I will repeat, fix, repeat again, repeat, repeat, repeat until the end, okay? So what we are going to talk is, at the first, we are talking about VoIP. What is it? Voice over IP, okay? Just a brief introduction. And after, I will introduce you AlexBoRT platform, okay? It's an embedded device. After, we will talk about NetBSD and the workflow for embedding and configuring, okay? This is my way to do the things. Maybe you have another way, maybe better, but this is my way, so we can share information after. Voice over IP, free switch configuration and usage examples, okay? I'm really sorry for today we don't have any working demonstration for because internet connectivity. So I can explain you what I have here. And this is the AlexBoRT, okay? It's an embedded platform. And the next slide, maybe, there is a picture for it. But let's begin talking about VoIP, voice over IP. So the great benefits are no pay for the distance, because all the calls are traveling into the wire, so in internet. So if you have, for instance, a phone here in Italy, in Österreich, and another phone in Italy, the distance is the same, okay, from a voice over IP perspective. Okay, so you don't have to pay for the call, because all the call is in internet, is packet switched, so there is no connectivity with some ISP, for instance, and you can organize a PBX, so you can have your server with the VoIP software on, and the VoIP clients working with the server interconnected by internet, so you don't have to pay. You can build your own service, okay? So you can configure and do fancy stuff, scripts, and it's very nice. Okay, so no geo barriers. That means the same as before, I told you. You can have a VoIP client in Italy, another one in India, for instance, there is no difference, okay? One in Germany, no difference. So there is no geographical limitation, okay? You can bring the service with you. This is even more interesting, because if you put this in your baggage and you go in Los Angeles, for instance, the services will come with you. You connect by DHCP, okay? And you will have your voice over IP number, your services in Los Angeles. Wherever you go, you bring with you your services, okay? You understand me? I'm trying to do my best, okay? So that's why you can invent your communication, because this is something of new, something really new. We are customized that to use the services from our local ISP. So, for instance, we have an ISP in Österreich, and he is serving us all the phone connectivity, all the phone services, but it's localized, okay? So imagine that if you go abroad and you bring with you your services, you can have a new world of communication. So you can, for instance, you can answer to an Italian number in Los Angeles without any cost. Okay? This is something of new. It's a new concept. Okay. Let's go on. Okay, this is our AlexBoRT. This is the front. It's very nice, it's very interesting, because, okay, can you see above there is the main CPU, on the right side the RAM, okay, RAM in English, I think. This small chip is the South Bridge, something like a South Bridge, okay? It's similar to a normal PC architecture, but it's slightly different. This This is very fine because it manages all the I/O. It's very nice. It's like a SoundBridge. After we have two chips, there are the two controllers, two Ethernet controllers, okay? Two Ethernet connectivity, 100 megabit, USB, RS232 console, and what else? Ah, the smart card flash. Can you see above there is the socket, no? For the storage, okay? Okay. Yeah, the B side is even more sexy because can you see over there above up there is the SIM card holder. Okay, so this board is engineered to work with the packet switching communication in GSM. Okay, so for instance, if you put inside a GSM modem. Let's try to go back to the previous slide. Yeah. For instance, if you put here, okay, this is a mini PCI holder. You can put inside a small GSM router, and it will work because there is a SIM holder. There is another one on the front of the board. You see? Okay. The gray one, close to the south bridge. There is a SIM holder. It's very nice. Okay. Our specifications, okay? AMD GOD CPU, okay, is a 500 MHz, and we have for memory 256 megabyte of RAM. Okay. Other things, interesting things are, okay, we have the SIM card slot. There is one mini PCI slot. You can even connect an IDE hard disk if you want. There is a header. And what else? You have E2C bus for connect some fancy sensors. Very nice. Okay. But the killer features, the power consumption is very low. It's very low. This is very nice because you can put it in some remote location, okay, and feed the power by a solar panel, for instance. And it's very reliable because you don't have any mechanical movement part inside, so you can leave it. In a remote location, and it would work. It's very nice. And there is an hardware crypto engine. Hardware crypto engine, not software, okay? Okay, let's talk about flash memories. The pros, here in the picture you see a smart card, okay? It's the same media I used to configure the Helix board. Actually, this smart card is inside, okay? So, low power, lower than the mechanical hard disk. Low latency, okay, because it's flash. And no mechanical failures, okay? Silence, absolutely. Okay, there is some problem with these flash memories because the life is limited. Okay, you know, because if you use the flash memory, if you write, many write program array cycles can enlow the life of the flash. This is something very, very important we have to consider because actually NetBSD adopted a new file system, is the CHFS file system, something new for 2012, is very nice, and specifically for these kind of problems, because you can't work with flash memory as you work with the hard disk, okay? You have to consider to limit your write cycles, or consider also to manage the bad blocks, okay? Because the life is limited. Okay. No swap partition, of course, because you can't swap inside this flash memory. Actually, they are a little bit more expensive than HDs, and the size actually are smaller. Okay, so NetBSD, welcome the new CHFS. Okay, this is something new from. I read the presentation email was in November 2011, and is something developed in Hungary in a university, engineering university. It's very nice because this kind of file system is specific for flash memory. So it has got log structured flash file system. It can manage web blocks, and is the first specific flash file system for NetBSD. All right. So why NetBSD? Okay. So many Linux, so many BSD. Why NetBSD? Because it's high portable, compact, it's clean, not many files around. It's very compact. It's security focused. The kernel is very. Even the kernel is very compact. It's built like a rock. It's clean. Okay. My impression is I'm really working with a Unix operative system. Okay. And there are many tools for embedding, of course, because NetBSD is primarily engineered for be ported to many, many different architectures. Okay. So our players. Our team, we are going to work with cross compilation, specifically the build script, DHCPD, TFTP for trivial serving file, okay, and boot the devices, PXE boot, NFS for sharing, okay. Okay, the battlefield. So. Let me explain you. Okay, here, this is my way, okay? Maybe you have another way, another maybe better than mine, but I'm very comfortable with this approach. I have a development server, okay, with all the serving software, our LX board connected by Ethernet, okay? There is the laptop or a workstation, okay, where you can program, configure, and everything. And the serial cable from my laptop coming inside the LX board, okay? Just to have a minicom or whatever program you use for serial connectivity, you open and you can follow all the workflow, okay, by serial. Because there are times without internet connectivity or LAN connectivity, so you can follow by serial, okay? It's very reliable. Okay, pay attention at this way to work. There is the PXE boot, okay? NFS root. We will take the. We will prepare a working root in the NFS server, okay? And we will export it to LX board. Is it clear? Yeah? Okay. And for the development purposes, we prepare a swap partition, okay? To serve to the LX board. Some question about this, because this is important to Yeah, tell me if somebody wants to know more, just ask. All right. Okay, the workflow. My friends, I want to introduce you my customized workflow, okay? I hope you will enjoy it. So, level one, the game. So you have to download all the files, set up the directories, and have all the files ready to begin. Okay. After we have to cross-compile. Okay. Cross-compile is faster than install inside something like this. Okay. Of course, there are in internet the PXE boot install, so you can have. A full install GUI here, and follow all the installation process here by serial communication, no? But it's very slow, very, very slow. Okay, because the processor is slower than a laptop with this kind of processor, and even the flash inside is slower. Writing to a flash memory is slower than writing to a mechanical hard disk. Is this clear enough? Yeah, oh, good. So we will install everything into the root to be ready to be exported by NFS to the Alyx, okay? After this, we can pass to the level 2. So PXE boot. Everybody know what is this? PXE, yeah, it's clear, okay. So after we boot the Alyx, okay, we take our IP, dynamic IP, we take our first files, the kernel, okay, from the TFTP server, okay, and we take the NFS partition, the root. After we continue with the configuring the operating system, we install our VoIP PBX and we test. Something wrong? No problem. We can begin. Reboot the machine and let's go on. Okay. So, cross-compiling, okay? You can see here in this slide, I want to export the NFS root partition to the laptop now, because I'm going to cross-compiling with my CPU, with the laptop CPU, okay? So I need to mount the NFS root into my laptop, okay? And we can forget for just maybe some hours. Maybe some hours of compiling, we can forget about the Alyx board. Okay, maybe somebody can ask, why we don't work with binaries? Okay, it's so simple. Let's go with binaries. Why? Okay, compiling has got several benefits, my friends. So everybody, I think, knows here, optimization, custom make option, okay? You can, the CPU flag, for instance, you can put your CPU flags. We can load our drivers, enable features. You will have a smaller and faster kernel, of course, because you will disable whatever you don't need, you everything. And it's more security and reliability, maybe. Okay. Why? Because maybe disabling a lot of features, maybe we can work around about bugs. Okay, some bugs, and we can have a better security of the platform. Cross-compiling benefits is faster, okay? If you try to inst from the Alyx board, it will be slow, very slow. So cross-compiling is the solution, okay? The storage is a flash. If we try to compile it straight into the Alyx board, we will have a problem with the flash memory because a lot of write, erase cycle and low the life of the flash. And of course, it is easy to have a versioning system to manage all your different version of release. Configuring an embedded kernel. This is very nice, a nice subject I like so much. So, the best is begin with a generic, tiny or generic kernel, okay? You can find in the configuration subdirectory of the architecture you are using. It's better at the beginning boot the device with a generic kernel, okay? So you can have a printout of the message and you can save it. No? To compare, you will use this output to compare with yours. When you will finish to compile the kernel, you can compare the two versions. Maybe there are some drivers missing, so oh they are different. Oh, okay. So I go back, I compile again my kernel, and I try to fix. Yeah, you can use several tools, okay, to understand about the devices inside your system. So you can use Modstat and PCI CTL commands, okay, and also have a printout of the hardware specification help. So remember to enable for this special kind of hardware. Please remember to enable the Southbridge drivers, okay? CS5536 chip gave the drivers, the VIA network drivers, or maybe in English VIA, something like that. GLXSB PCI cryptographic device if you use it. Disable all the modules you don't need, and please set the speed of the kernel at 1000. Okay, this is something hard to have the documentation about this. Okay, but this is if you work with VoIP, voice over IP, is a must. You can't work without this. Will be flickering voice, will be losing packets. Because voice over IP is like a real-time communication. So the kernel have to be fast enough to manage all the packets, okay? I know that this, putting this speed has got some cons, you understand? But for the voice over IP, you have to manage responsiveness of the system, okay? This is most important thing. Okay, so prepare the files. Download everything by CVS, okay? Here you can see the command I used, okay? Easy to update because you can update all the tree, all the source tree using the last command, okay? Imagine if you use the binary distribution and there is an update, you have to download everything, and with the CVS you can download just the files, the new files, the changes, okay? Cross-compiling, hello build sh. This nice script is very good because will help us a lot to do our cross-compiling work. So, three steps. We cross-compile the tools after the kernel and after the user land, okay? The tools, the tool chain, here you can see briefly the commands I used. There is also, to update without clean, just put a minus U, okay? It will not clean everything and lose a lot of time. After we cross-compile the user land and the kernel, I'm sorry if I show you my back. Eh? So you can see build sh kernel, my specific kernel, because I prepared my configuration, okay? So I pass to the command, I want to use that kernel, okay? After to cross-compile the kernel and the user land, okay, you can have one command like this, okay? This is very well you can have all the documentation about that at this URL, okay? I will give you, if you want to download these slides, they are on GitHub, okay? GitHub. After, in the end, you will see the address. Let's go on. Okay, so now, after cross-compiling, what we have? We have a build directory, okay, with all the subdirectories. Remember that we began from this src directory, okay? And using the build.sh script, it prepared all the other directories, okay? It's important now, read every time the final output into the console. After when build.sh finish, there is an output, and this you have to save it and store it, because it will give you all the all the directories, all the address directories it used to produce the kernel, the user land, okay? So it's better save it. Okay, you can copy the new kernel to TFTP directory, okay? Because we are ready to use this new kernel. But we have to fix some option into the DHCPD server, okay? And we are ready to export by NFS to the Alix port. So I show you again. Now we go back. We go back to this design. We are going to use the Alix port now, monitoring all the bootstrap process by serial cable, okay? The Alix board is connected by LAN to the development server. Okay. Alix board will take the NFS root, the swap partition, and the NetBSD kernel from PXE, okay? And another small file that I'm going to show you. Okay, before giving the NetBSD kernel, we have to give another file before, okay? So, the Alix board has to download before PXE boot. This is a binary that bootstrap all the process. Will pass, this file will pass the kernel to the Alix board. Okay, is it clear? I hope. So we can download this file from the URL is here. We can enable the serial console with install boot, and we are ready after to move this file into the TFTP directory. Okay, inside you can see the URL. Inside this repository, you can have all the script, all the configuration file I used, okay? So you can, just for reference, if you need. Let's go on. This is a screenshot about booting the Alix board, okay? Right, and now I'm connected by serial cable, and the first thing I see is this. Okay, this is the Alix board BIOS. Okay, so you can have all the options, the speed setting, the storage media options. You can enable the PXE boot, because if you don't enable it will not boot. So you have to enable it. To get inside, just press the S key. Okay, it's written, I think. Maybe later. Okay, it's not written. This is strange because... it's written into the repository, okay? Because I've written down some how-tos here, and there you will find all the steps to follow to reproduce this output, okay? Good. So we are ready. We are ready for the first testing boot, okay? Okay, here we have minicom screenshot. It's important, remember, to compare these lines to a generic kernel bootstrap. To compare what is missing, which driver I didn't enable, okay? So you can compare the two versions and understand very easily where you have to work. Fix, recompile, and reboot, okay? Okay, yeah, something wrong, okay. Keep patient, please. Go back, review the kernel, fix, recompile, and reboot, yes. Okay, what about an embedded NetBSD? This is even more interesting, guys, because you have to do some configuration about the operating system, into the operating system, and specifically, we begin with sysinst installation, okay? And we use NFS. You will have all your release set prepared in the NFS server, okay? So we can tell to the sysinstall process to take all the source set, the compiled set from NFS. Okay. After, in an embedded environment, usually you have to disable all the unneeded services. Okay, it's a really small environment, so you have to keep it small. Usually the memory is low, so pay attention. For instance, if I don't need it, for instance, I switch off postfix. Postfix and the queue manager, and sometime I switch off also the syslog server, okay? Because this is an embedded device, there is no syslog. Maybe you prepare the syslog into the RAM, okay? Preparing a separate partition mounted into the RAM, but you can have the verbosity of the log can't be so big, no? Because it's a really small environment, okay? So you have to pay attention. It's like a it's like doing some surgery. You understand surgery? Yeah. Okay. Disable TTEs. All the serial console that you don't need. Please put this option in the F tab. No at time. Okay. So this is for the flash memory. The flash card, okay? Because with the NOAA time option enabled, the operating system will not update the access time every time, okay? To all the files. So, you of course you have to create some RAM disk, okay? To put var and TMP into the memory, okay? All the variable stuff have to be into the RAM. You can't use the flash because you will destroy it. Imagine you are going to leave it maybe abroad at 1,000 kilometers, and this has to be very reliable. So all the pay attention at accessing too much to the flash can destroy it. That's why it's better to have a var partition and TMP partition into the RAM. Okay, we delete unused files, for instance, the share partition, the manuals, the documentation, the example script, okay? We don't need it, okay. This time we don't need it. We can enable SSH, and we can write a simple init file, okay? A smaller one. Just to run our software, for instance, our voice over IP software, we will need a small init. Okay, we don't need the big init usually come with the distribution set. And in the end, if everything is good and everything is fine and everything is working, okay, you can put the root file system read-only. Okay, but this is the real last thing. Okay, after some work. Of course, there are alternative ways. Okay. Now I'm going to read. You can create crunched binaries. There is a tool. This tool is Crungen. Okay. So what's the problem here? Imagine you have a lot of software. They share a lot of libraries. Sometimes are statically linked. Sometimes are shared libraries. Okay. So this big picture has got several cons. That's why NetBSD, even in FreeBSD, I think there is the CrunchGen. It combines all binaries in the end, their libraries in one super binary. Okay, this is a like an abstraction for you, no? To let you understand. It uses hard links. Okay, so files is like file system alias for a program to point to linked binary. So you can have a super binary. Okay. And all the software you use point to this big binary. So you don't have to use the overhead of the shared libraries, okay? After when you do some of this operation, you can use makefs to wrap the file system in an image file, okay? And you will use this image file to boot the LX board and put everything into the root. into the RAM. So the root file system, the kernel, will go straight into the RAM. And the compact flash will have just as an image, okay? We were working with a different approach. We were working with a root file system inside the compact flash. These alternative ways, okay, show you how to have an image file into the compact flash and load everything into the RAM, okay? In-memory file system, so I was telling you, will be an in-memory file system, embed a root file system into the kernel, straight into the kernel. Of course, this will increase the memory usage. Will be a fast diskless. This time is diskless because it reads just at the bootstrap. Okay? It reads from the compact flash at the bootstrap, but will be a fast diskless device. And of course, we have to enable some special kernel option for manage memory disk. Is it clear? This is very complicated. Huh? You have to manage, you have to try, you have to. Okay. Okay, different approach. We can have another way also. We were working in the beginning, I show you how to work with an NFS exported root. But we can have another way. So we can write in the operating system in a compact flash card, for instance, the compact flash card inside the Alex board. We can use tools like fdisk, this label, newfs, mount, okay, these are the tools, build, sh of before. We can work on the development server, but we need a compact flash reader. So we have to prepare the server to write straight the operating system inside the compact flash, and after, take it off and put inside the Alice port, ready to bootstrap, okay? Somebody's sleeping, I have to hurry up, I know. Okay, so let's go on fast. Let's talk about voice over IP, okay? So we use, there are two options, main option, actually into the market, asterisk and free switch. My opinion, free switch is very nice, okay? But all the rest of the people use asterisk, okay? But it's up to you. There are several benefits using free switch. So you can, inside this, there is asterisk to show you another install, but I'm going to explain you how to install free switch. So you have to download free switch from the last Git tree. After you have to edit the modules, .conf, and ready to configure, okay? And this is the flag to use, the right for specifically for NetBSD. If you don't use it, you will have some error. And after compile and install gmake, there are several gmake to repeat, okay, to install FreeSwitch. Okay, you have to configure FreeSwitch with XML files, okay? So you can configure SIP accounts, the VoIP gateways. The VoIP gateways are phones like this, or soft phones, okay? These are your VoIP gateways. And the trunk, for instance, you have an ISP. I don't know if I can write here. Imagine you have your ISP. He is giving you special voice over IP services, for instance, a telephone number, a local one, but he's going to serve this telephone number by voice over IP, okay? So you have a subscription, you have an agreement, you have to pay a fee, and you can have your service, okay? So you have to configure all this stuff inside inside this directory. In my GitHub repository, there are some examples about that. The dial plan. The dial plan is the flow of the call flow, okay? So the call The call begins from here. Get inside your PBX. There is a line. There is a configuration file. It's like a flow. Every line do something different. For instance, let's analyze who is calling. Okay. Let's analyze where this call is going. Okay. So I have to call this number. Okay. So and after connect with the ESP and pass the call to the ESP. And after that, write to the log, for instance, or for the billing. No. So this is the dial plan, briefly. This is an example to configure a VoIP phone. Pure XML, okay? So you have the password, the username, okay? You can see the second line, ID. This is the username, the password, voicemail password, and the account for the billing, user context, because the user context is nice, because you can have a dial plan divided by context. So you can, for instance, this VoIP phone has got that part of the plane. Another VoIP phone, another part. You can have different contexts and switch between the context programmatically. Okay? It's nice. That's why I told you, you can invent your communication because everything is open. You can combine different services and in the end have something incredible. Okay, so voice over IP. This concept has to be clear. There are no limits, no geographical limits. Okay, so if you have, for instance, your PBX in USA and you put your voice, of course, are static IP. Okay, this is working just if you use static IP. So Alex Board in USA. And the VoIP phone somewhere in Africa, and it will work, okay? Without any extra fees. Okay, this is a flow, a call flow, specifically for was the testing environment to show you today. So we have a VoIP phone connected to the Alix by Ethernet cable. And the Ethernet cable goes somewhere in Italy, and somebody can answer. Do? yeah, but we finished that. The big picture, people, understand this, and you will be rich. Okay. So you have a VoIP phone, Alex Board, internet, the big ISP. You are stealing the business to the ISP. This is the truth. Because usually ISP work is selling you the services, okay? But what, if you do your services, and for instance, you bring abroad your service, this will be for you very cheap and a big mess for the ISP, because they don't want. So this is the really interesting part of voice over IP. You can see the call flow come from VN and go to Italy. I'm using an voice over IP exported telephone number, an Italian number, but I can have this number here. So, for instance, if somebody call 003902 Milan telephone number, he can answer from VN, from here, okay? No need to stay in Italy to use an Italian number. This is something new. Is it clear? Some other great ideas about what you can do with this Alix board. So you can have a voicemail. Of course, we have to enable POSFIX and use a remote server, okay, to load in Dovecot, for instance, load all the mails ready to read. We can leave the messages in an email box. This is useful because if you are not in your home, you can have your mailbox, you can access your mailbox, for instance, abroad or from another city, just going to the internet, no? By internet. We can save all the audio messages in MP3 or WAV. is easy to organize and find, because you can, in Thunderbird, for instance, you can have a search filter. You can looking for a message from your friend, for instance. It's available everywhere, I told you. And least, but not last, decentralized storage. Okay. What happened? In a business environment, usually there is a local PBX to manage everything. Okay? They manage the voicemail locally. So there is a, you can have also a RAID storage system, but it's local. If something happened there, maybe some business will not work today. But if you use VoIP, voice over IP, this is good, because you can have a remote voicemail service. Okay, so you can save all the voicemail messages somewhere else. Okay, other ideas. So I told you your telephone number comes with you. So if you have a local geographical telephone number from Vienna and you go to India, you bring with you your telephone number. And the people from Vienna can use the same telephone number. No extra fees to pay. Yeah. And this is very simple, because you don't have to subscribe agreement and papers. It works immediately. You don't have to wait nobody. So you take your phone, you go abroad, you connect, and it's working. Good. And this happened to me because there was a company asking me to develop a project. How to say in English is. When there are a lot of people sit down and they have to call a lot of people all the day, for instance, for screening, no, the population. Yeah, call center. Okay, for instance, call center. They asked me to produce a project for exporting all the call center in Croatia, where the salary are lower, okay? And what to do? The numeration is Italian numeration. It's impossible to have an agreement between Croatia and Telecom Italia and Connect. It's very hard and expensive. So what to do? VoIP, voice over IP. Export all the office abroad, save a lot of money, and go by internet, okay? They did it, and it was fine. It was interesting. No demo VoIP call. Sorry. So enjoy your PBX. We finished.